Whirlwind's Mage is a free-to-play open-world action RPG developed by Everstone Studio. Despite its free-to-play model, the game is showing a lot of ambition, especially on the technical side. This is not another Unreal Engine 5 game. Instead, it's powered by NetEase's in-house Messiah engine, and the results are genuinely impressive. Visually, despite some limitations in global illumination, lighting, and character rendering, the game has an amazing and stunning art direction that strongly reminds me of Ghost of Tsushima. The environments look fantastic, particularly the dense foliage and vegetation combined with the reactive wind system, dynamic weather, and a full day-night cycle. Everything works together to bring the art direction to life and to give the game its beautiful and richly detailed look. And honestly, I did not expect this level of visual richness and polish from a free-to-play MMO. On the performance side though, things are slightly less impressive. The game suffers from some shader compilation and traversal stutters, especially in dense areas, like towns and villages. It also comes with two APIs, DX11 and DX12. On my system, DX11 generally delivers better overall performance and more stable frame pacing. For example, in this cutscene, notice how the frame time spikes are noticeably larger and more frequent on DX12 compared to DX11. The same applies to regular gameplay. The frame time graph is much flatter in DX11 while DX12 produces more spikes. Of course, performance differences between the two APIs can vary depending on your hardware. That's why I want you to share your specs in the comments below and let us know which API performs better on your system. Also, there is one downside of using DX11, which is the lack of DLSS, XeSS, and frame generation support, since these features are only available when running the game in DX12. Speaking of DLSS and XeSS, let's take a look at how each upscaler looks and performs. At 1440p in quality mode, FSR3 appears slightly sharper, but as usual, it suffers from noticeable aliasing and shimmering. XeSS is the softest of the bunch, but it delivers far better stability than FSR3 and comes much closer to DLSS and overall quality. And it's the same story at native resolution. FSR3 remains the least stable, while the game's built-in TAA also shows some shimmering and aliasing. Meanwhile, both DLAA and XeSS deliver the cleanest image overall. Now when it comes to DLSS, the game defaults to preset D, which is a pretty unusual choice. But we can force the newer Transformer model with preset K, and in my opinion, the easiest way to do that is through the Nvidia app. Just go to graphics, click the three dots, add a program, navigate to the game's folder, go to this location and select wwm.exe. Then click on DLSS override model preset, choose latest or manually set super resolution to preset K. And finally click apply. As you can see here, the DLSS preset K looks noticeably cleaner and overall much better in this game. So for upscaling and anti-aliasing, if DLSS is an option, I highly recommend using the Transformer model with preset K. If you can't use DLSS or FSR4, I recommend avoiding FSR3 and going with either XeSS or the game's TAA. As for the game's graphic settings, I noticed some unusual behavior that's worth pointing out. It seems that the Ultra preset runs significantly slower compared to manually setting every option to its maximum value. What do I mean by that? Let's take a look at this scene. Here the game is running on the performance preset. If I manually set every setting to its maximum, performance drops to around 80 FPS. But if I go back to the graphics menu and select the Ultra preset, the frame rate drops further to about 64 FPS. So it seems the game is changing some hidden graphics settings when using the presets, which explains the unexpected performance gap. Visually, I also noticed some differences. For example, notice how the terrain bumpiness changes when switching back and forth between max settings and the Ultra preset. But the more noticeable difference is shadow quality, which isn't available in the menu, yet using the Ultra preset noticeably improves the resolution and overall quality of the shadow maps. So for now, I recommend starting with the performance preset before tweaking the settings manually to get the best performance. And I hope Everstone Studio exposes the hidden graphics settings and makes them available in the menu with future updates. With that out of the way, let's dive into the graphics settings, starting with ambient occlusion. This one doesn't have a significant visual impact. High slightly increases the intensity of ambient occlusion with a minimal performance hit, so I recommend leaving this one at high. Moving on to tessellation, which should enhance the bumpiness and level of detail on surfaces like terrain. However, in this game, the differences are so subtle and barely noticeable. Low and high look identical, while medium shows just a slight variation. Despite this minimal visual gain, the setting has a significant performance impact, especially on high. Surprisingly, medium delivers the best performance overall. I double-checked across multiple scenes and the results were consistent, so I recommend leaving tessellation at medium. Next, we have vegetation quality. This one adjusts the draw distance and level of detail of grass, trees, and other plants, as you can see here. It also impacts the animation of distant foliage. Notice how high and ultra make these trees sway more smoothly and naturally compared to low and medium. When it comes to popping, high and ultra are noticeably more stable, while low and medium show more visible transitions. Performance-wise, there is roughly a 5% cost when going from low to medium, 11% when going to high, and about 13% when using ultra. So for this one, if some popping doesn't bother you, stick with medium. Otherwise, go for high if you have some performance to spare for better stability. Let's move on to lighting quality. This one affects the complexity of dynamic lights and how they interact with nearby surfaces. Like here, with medium and high, sunlight bounces into the wall and roof, whereas on low, that indirect lighting is missing. Or here, where the candle's light is completely absent on low but properly illuminates the area on medium and high. Performance-wise, I tested this setting across multiple scenes and couldn't measure any noticeable impact. So for this one, I recommend using medium or high. Next up is view distance, which is similar to vegetation quality but affects the level of detail of walls, buildings, and other environmental elements. Generally, it doesn't have a significant visual impact and doesn't help much with pop-in. Like here, where objects on both low and ultra pop into view suddenly at almost the same distance. This minimal visual difference carries over to performance, where even jumping from low to ultra doesn't result in any noticeable performance drop. So for this one, I recommend high or ultra. Moving on to effect quality, this setting should adjust the quality of particles and special effects. But after testing it across multiple scenes with fire and smoke effects, as you can see here, and with other special effects as well, I couldn't notice any visual differences. Performance-wise, only a few scenes like this one showed a small difference between low and high. Now, since the game's combat system heavily relies on particles and special effects, and considering there are no noticeable visual differences between low and high, I recommend keeping this one at low as a safe choice to avoid any potential performance drops during intense combat scenarios. Let's move on to reflection quality, which primarily affects screen space reflections. On large bodies of water, this setting has a small impact. SSR accuracy is slightly better on ultra compared to low and medium. On smaller bodies of water like puddles and other reflective surfaces, low completely disables SSR, leaving only the cube map fallback visible. However, as you can see here, SSR on these smaller surfaces is broken, showing a lot of noise and flickering. Performance-wise, there is roughly a 5-6% cost when moving from low to medium and ultra. Therefore, I recommend keeping reflection quality at low. This preserves SSR on large bodies of water while disabling the broken SSR on smaller reflective surfaces for cleaner and more stable visuals overall.
What are you waiting for? Let's move!
Finally, we have real-time sunlight. This setting controls how sunlight and sun shadows react to environmental occlusion. Notice here how even when the sun is blocked by these trees, sunlight leaks through when this setting is disabled. This one also determines whether shadows position update dynamically with the sun and time of day, as you can see here. Performance-wise, it doesn't have a major impact. There is only about a 2-3% cost. So if you like the visual changes this setting provides and want a more realistic representation of sunlight and shadows, I recommend keeping it enabled. So given everything we've discussed so far, these are my recommended settings for Where Winds Meet. Now let's compare the performance and visuals of the optimized settings against the Epic preset at 1440p using DLNA with preset K, which I know is a bit overkill for this GPU, and quality DLSS4 would be a smarter choice, but I am using DLNA preset K just to create the worst case scenario for both sides. Here on average we see roughly a 39% performance improvement when going from the Ultra preset to the optimized settings. Before ending the video, I want to give a quick shout out to my Patreon. If you are able and would like to directly support my work, consider becoming a patron to get access to the highest possible quality of my latest videos, including this one. And a big thank you to all my supporters, and thanks to you as well for watching until the end. If you enjoyed the video, leave a like, and if not, leave a dislike. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell so you don't miss any future videos, and hopefully I'll see you all in the next one.